This video is sponsored by Artlist and Artgrid. If you're looking for the ultimate destination for royalty-free music and video footage, then this is it. So if you're interested and want to support the channel at the same time, use the referral links down below and get 2 extra free months with your subscription. What's up guys and welcome back to From the Attic. The year is almost over, so I wanted to look back on it and talk about my favorite games of 2021. Despite it not being a fantastic year for video games, in my opinion, I still played a bunch of really great stuff this year, and I also got the chance to play a lot more indie games than I usually do. I mean, half of my list are indie titles, so that should give you an idea. But before I jump into it, I just wanted to thank you guys so much for the support you have been giving me throughout the whole entire year. I recently reached 4,000 subscribers, which is a crazy milestone for me. 2022 is looking absolutely insane in terms of game releases, so next year is most likely going to be a freaking blast on the channel, so I cannot wait to experience it with you guys. But that's enough chit-chat, let's talk about my favorite video games of 2021. Sadly, I wasn't able to play every game that released this year. Also, I don't have a Nintendo Switch, an Xbox, or a gaming PC. I'm sure there are plenty of games that could have made this list that I couldn't play or just didn't have the time to try out. Things like Deathloop, Guardians of the Galaxy, Halo Infinite, Metroid Dread, Hitman 3, or It Takes Two. And there's also games that I had a lot of fun with but that just didn't make my list, like Psychonauts 2, Far Cry 6, or Fantasian, just to name a few. So keep that in mind as I'm going through my top 10 list. Without further ado, let's dive into it. I've always been a big fan of crime investigations, and unfortunately, I feel like games usually miss the mark when it comes to providing truly compelling murder mysteries. Games like L.A. Noire, for instance, absolutely nail the atmosphere of detective stories but kind of fail at translating the genre into engaging gameplay mechanics. But one game that succeeded this year was Sherlock Holmes Chapter 1. This is the type of experience that doesn't hold the player by the hand. The game will never tell you where to go and what should be the next step in your investigations. And if you want, you can make it even more difficult by entirely removing tips, which provides an extremely engaging experience. Because once you gather clues on the different crime scenes, you'll need to figure out what to do with them. Should you talk to witnesses, pay a visit to the local police station, search in the city archives, whatever it is, Chapter 1 believes that you can come to conclusions on your own, and I love that. Over the years, I've grown tired of linear, story-driven games with barely any gameplay. But there are exceptions, of course. And these exceptions are usually on the short side and also feature some of the best world-building out there. Games like Limbo, Inside, Little Nightmares, and now, Little Nightmares 2. From a gameplay perspective, there really isn't that much to say, honestly. I mean, this is a very straightforward platformer, but if you played the first game, you would know that gameplay was never its biggest strength. Little Nightmares was all about atmosphere, and the second one brings it to a whole different level thanks to its beautifully haunting world. The cinematography, the art direction, and the sound design are just so, so good. Whether you're walking around a creepy forest, discovering the remains of an abandoned city, stumbling across the weirdest school of all time, or exploring a spooky hospital, Little Nightmares 2 manages to remain consistently intriguing and unsettling. And this is mainly thanks to the great environmental storytelling, because not a single word is spoken in that game, which means that every piece of narrative is gathered as you explore and interact with the environment. The developers managed to create a truly twisted and disturbing world that was very fun to unravel. I love mascot platformers. I mean, these were my favorite games during the PlayStation 2 era. Jak and Daxter, Sly Cooper, and of course, Ratchet and Clank. And these two were lucky enough to receive multiple new entries throughout the years, so it makes a whole lot of sense for a new Ratchet game to release when a brand new console comes out. And Rift Apart is really good. Although, don't expect it to break new grounds. I mean, if you played the previous games, you know exactly what to expect, but it's so much fun. And honestly, I just miss those kinds of games. Rift Apart felt like the most beautiful Saturday morning cartoon ever created. Visually speaking, it was simply astonishing. From the gorgeous character designs to the amazing animation work, this game was a true next-gen showcase for me. And we're just at the start of the generation. Good lord. Shooting felt amazing with the adaptive triggers, and exploring the different planets was a blast thanks to the incredibly responsive controls and a surprising amount of variety. Is this an experience that I'm going to remember for years to come? No, probably not, but if you want to feel like a kid again and want to play something that will blow your mind with its visuals, then this is the perfect game. Alright, picture this, an RPG adventure with Dark Souls-inspired combat featuring rats. Yes, this is the pitch for Tales of Iron. When I first saw this game, I was immediately hooked. The storybook art style, the music, and the voiceover by the Witcher himself were enough for me to add this game to my wishlist. And when I finally got to try it out, I was quite shocked, because this is like freaking awesome and nobody is talking about it. It's driving me completely nuts. The art direction alone was enough to hook me in, but what kept me invested was the gameplay. This game revolves around the idea of repairing your castle while also trying to repel a frog invasion, so you need to explore this super charming world and do bounty hunts to collect gold, new weapons, and armor. And the combat system is surprisingly punishing and challenging. Enemies are super aggressive, which forces you to use every tool at your disposal. You can dodge, parry, switch between light and heavy weapons, poison your blades, or even use your bow and arrow. And every fight ends with an epic finishing move. Despite a lot of padding and backtracking, this gameplay loop never got boring during my 6-hour playthrough. Plus, the game is only 30 bucks, so I highly recommend it. My favorite game of last year was Ghost of Tsushima, so when I heard there was a director's cut coming out with added PS5 features and a full expansion featuring a brand new island with a complete new storyline, I was very excited. And playing Iki Island just reminded me why I love this game so much, because let's be honest, this expansion is more of the same, but if you wanted more Ghost of Tsushima, Iki Island is exactly that. This is a world that I just love to be in. It looks absolutely insane on PS5, and with the adaptive triggers, 3D audio, and haptic feedback, this new director's cut is simply the most immersive way to experience this masterpiece. And with this expansion, Sucker Punch added new enemy types, a new armor set, new horse abilities, a bunch of content, and a really good storyline that explores Jin's dark and traumatic past. And now when you include this great DLC and the surprisingly solid multiplayer mode, you get a package that is a must-buy for every PlayStation owner. What if I told you that one of the creepiest games of the year is also a deck-building roguelike? Yes, I'm talking about Inscription. This is by far the most unique game I've played in 2021. There's really nothing like it, and honestly, it's almost impossible to describe what this game is without spoiling the whole thing. Just know that it's from the same creator of Pony Island, which means that it features a bunch of mind-melting twists. Like I said in my video about disturbing horror games, Inscription is like being locked in a cabin with the devil himself while being forced to play the most twisted card game of all time. But even then, this only covers like 20% of what the game actually is, because it's full of surprises and design choices that will leave you scratching your head thinking, what the hell is going on? And diving into this weird and bizarre world has been one of my favorite gaming experiences this year, and easily the most fascinating. Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart wasn't the only one to look into the past this year, and if there's one game that perfectly captured the essence of games from my childhood, it's Kena: Bridge of Spirits. This is the very first game from developer Ember Labs, and holy crap, they knocked it out of the park. This game harkens back to late 90s to early 2000s action-adventure games like The Legend of Zelda and Jak and Daxter, but there's also hints of Metroidvanias in there. You have the puzzles, the lock and key systems, the bosses, the interconnected world design, and lots of other little components from gaming's golden age. Kena is pretty much what happens when a developer takes the core DNA of a bunch of games and creates a mishmash of ideas that manages to stick together wonderfully well. And the funny thing about this game is that simply giving a list of features doesn't even come close to describing the fun I had with it. The feeling of adventure, the wonderful visuals, the music, the story, everything simply clicked with me. And unlike Rift Apart, which felt like a somewhat modernized take on old-school game design, Kena replicates my earliest memories with video games. It provides a childish sense of wonder that I desperately needed at this particular time. If there's one game that I absolutely adored this year but that sadly went under everybody's radar, is Tormented Souls. This is a very deliberate throwback to the days of classic survival horror games like Resident Evil. And honestly, there's plenty of releases who try to emulate what made these early games so effective and special, but Tormented Souls is really one of the few truly successful attempts. This game is like if a weird, unreleased Resident Evil spin-off had been put inside a time capsule only to be opened decades later. It's so freaking good. And don't let the campy voice acting and its unknown developer fool you, because every component of Tormented Souls is extremely well-crafted. The puzzles, for instance, can be batshit crazy and are easily some of the best I've seen in a very long time, and exploring this creepy mansion turned into an hospital is just as exciting and engaging as exploring the Spencer Mansion for the first time. Seriously, if you like classic survival horror games, this is as good as it gets. And believe me, you'll play it every Halloween from now on. I've never been a big fan of Housemarque, not because I think their early games were bad, but I just never clicked with them. That is until Returnal. This is a third-person shooter with roguelike elements in which you play a scientist named Celine who must survive in a shape-shifting world after crash-landing right in the middle of a dangerous time loop. This game is amazing, and it's also the most fun I've had with a game this year. The combat alone is simply insane. Like I said in my review, it's like a mix of Doom and the most extreme version of dodgeball. It's all about movement. Trying to shoot dozens of enemies while dodging walls of energy spheres was a blast, and when you take into account the stupid amount of particle effects, you get some of the craziest visual scapes of the year. On top of that, you get an awesome time loop concept mixed with pretty good roguelike mechanics. And even though Returnal doesn't have the variety of games like Binding of Isaac, each run was different enough to keep me engaged. And when I say keep me engaged, I mean for hours and hours. This is the kind of game that is very easy to become addicted to. I always wanted to push further, learn more about Celine's story, find new items, new weapon types, and get better at the game. And trust me, you'll need some practice, because at first Returnal is gonna kick your ass and you're gonna die a lot. But much like Dark Souls or Bloodborne, pain is part of the experience, and if you enjoy the learning process that comes with these types of games, then Returnal is definitely for you. And my favorite game of 2021 is Resident Evil Village. Recently, I looked at my game of the year of the past decade, and I was surprised to find not one, but two Resident Evil games in there. But now you can officially add Village to that list. Not only is this my favorite game of the year, but it's also one of my favorite entry in the series. To me, this is simply the ultimate Resident Evil experience. It nails absolutely everything that made me fall in love with that series in the first place. The way the game is structured is also really cool. It's pretty much like the nightmarish version of Magic Kingdom. You have a hub world at the center, which branches off into four themed lands. And the art direction is simply spectacular. The hub, for instance, is this super creepy European village that you can explore to find secret areas, new items, and even optional boss fights. But the real stars of the show are the Four Lords. And what's cool is that the four main locations you visit are basically small Resident Evil experiences, each with unique components. Castle Dimitris is the closest to the classic level design of the series, with locks, keys, and puzzles, while House Beneviento, on the other hand, is a full-on PT-inspired level that really focuses on the scares and the atmosphere. The Reservoir is an over-the-top and grotesque chase sequence that reminded me a lot of Resident Evil 4, and the Factory is this never-ending maze of steel. I played this game 4 times already and I don't see myself ever getting bored of it. That's how freaking good this game is. So that was my top 10 list for 2021. Now it's your turn to tell me in the comments down below what were your favorite games of the year. Once again, thank you guys so much for the amazing 12 months. I hope I will find you all on my channel in 2022, because with the amount of really cool stuff coming out, I'm sure we'll have a lot of fun, and I just really like to do this YouTube stuff, so it means a lot to me that so many people actually like my content. If you enjoy what I do, don't forget to like and subscribe, and if you want to support the channel, you can make donations through Ko-fi or buy a subscription to Artlist and Artgrid via the links down below. That's pretty much it, and I'll see you all next year.